lying, stealing, cheat. She'll beg you from her knees. She'll make you think she needs it this time. She'll tear a hole in you, one you can't repair. But I still love her, I don't even care. When we were young, oh, oh, we did enough. When it got cold, ooh, ooh, we bundled up. And I can't be told, ah, ah, it can't be done. Cause it's better to feel pain than nothing at all. The opposite of love's indifference. So pay attention now. You're standing on your fourth street and I won't even feel you come downstairs. When we were young, oh, oh, we did enough. When it got cold, oh, oh, we bundled up. And I can't be told, ah, ah, it can't be done. So keep your head up, my love. 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 And I don't play the ear. You're running like you did all those years. And I would do the same, you best believe. The highway signs say we're close, but I don't read those things anymore. I've never trusted my own eyes. So keep your head up, my love. So keep your head up, my love. So keep your head up, my love. So keep your head up, my love.
So that could be a problem too. Thanks for coming this evening. We do have Rick and Val to thank for the use of the space, owners of the Creamery here in Centreville. Thank you very much. And once again, I was not required to give a security deposit, so that works out very well for me. So have a great time.
We've got a wonderful show for you tonight. But before we get started on that, what is the deal with the weather here in Maryland, huh? I mean, my word. I mean, 68 today, 30 Saturday. I think someone's playing a trick on us. I think someone's got a good sense of humor. We're being showed global warming and also glacial progress all in 1 week. Unbelievable. Unbelievable. Wow, my mic just went on and off. I was talking to a friend of mine today out driving around, and every week he and his buddy, they go out to dinner together. His name's Harry. The other fella's name's Mort. They bring their wives. The guys ride in the front seat. The ladies ride in the back. So Harry says to Mort, he says, Mort, where are we going to go to dinner tonight? And Mort says, well, why don't we go to that Italian place? Harry says, oh, I don't know, remember an Italian place. Mort says, sure you do. It's the one where the lasagna was so good. Huh? Harry says, I don't remember an Italian place. I don't remember lasagna. Harry looks at Mort and says, give me a name of a flower, any flower. He looks at him. Mort looks at him, a tulip? Harry says, no, 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 give me another one. Mort looks at him, daisy? No, 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 it's a basic flower, it's a basic flower. Mort says to him, Rose? That's it. Hey, Rose, what's the name of that restaurant that we like so much? All right, now I got some levity out of you, great. So we've got some wonderful guests this evening. We're going to hear from a number of them. We have Jenny Wickline, who is a wellness coach. And this is being our theme, New Beginnings. It's important that we have listened to her because she may set us on the track for 2017 to be the most successful for us. We'll hear from the Black Knights and, of course, Brent Schraffenberger later. And Nick Hoxtra, author, local author, brought some of his books here. And we're going to share an interview with all these folks. But I sure would like to hear more from Brent. Would you not? All right, let's do another one, Brent. Thank you.
Watching the clock, you better stop, I'm so complacent, adjacent to love. And I'm always chasing the person I was, just because he always seemed to know who he was. Sitting at the end of the road, and there's no way to go. I'm looking at the trouble of zone, and I know there ain't no turning back. No, there's no turning back. No, I'm not turning back. No, there's no turning back. I can't stop pacing, creating a hole in the floor. It's broken, I'm sure. And I'm so impatient, the faith in what I desire causes blatant, try not to expire. I'm sitting at the end of the road, and there's no way to go. I'm looking at the trouble of zone, and I know there ain't no turning back. No, there's no turning back. No, I'm not turning back. No, there's no turning back. Sitting at the end of the road, and there's no way to go. I'm looking at the trouble that's on, and I know there ain't no turning back. No, there's no turning back. No, I'm not turning back. No, there's no turning back.
Well, I'm your MC for the evening. My name is Stephen Hazzard, and I appreciate you all being here this tonight. We are covering New Beginnings, this being the first part of 2017, and we're fortunate enough to have with us this evening a Jenny Wickline, who is a coach who is going to help us through some of our difficult times. Jenny is a certified health and wellness coach. Meditation and the love of learning has been part of Jennifer's life for over 30 years. She has faced many of life's challenges over the years, type 2 diabetes, depression, and even a small form of lung cancer. Ugh. Jennifer used her senses of play and determination to lose 55 pounds and counting by training her brain for positive thinking and mindful movement. These personal successes sparked a passion to help others to find their healthy and happy path in life. Jennifer now coaches individuals with wellness goals, teaching mindful eating. Ladies and gentlemen, it gives me great pleasure to welcome to the stage Miss Jennifer Wickline. Yep.
Hi, everybody. How are you tonight? Good, good. As a coach, you always want to check in with your audience or check in with the person that you're coaching. So that's what I just did. Quick check-in. That's very short, actually. So tonight, I just thought I'd raise awareness to what wellness coaching is. I like to call myself a wellness coach, but my actual title is a certified health and wellness coach. I go to the Maryland University of Integrated Health. I'm finishing my master's so that I have a little bit more to give to my clients. And we learn holistic care, so we have a lot of research-based classes that we learn. One of them was mindful eating, and I had to find a lot of research articles. So I'm going to do a short, quick mindful eating meditation in just a quick moment. But in wellness coaching, we take what your goals are. So we use this tool called DARM, and we want to find out your desire. What is your what do you want to change? And then your ability. What can you change about your situation? Some things can't be changed. And then the reason for that change. It's normally a very personal reason. And then is there a need to change? And so we take in all that assessment and we work with you with that. And then we want to work with you to then get you to that goal. So we use, I like this tool, it's called the ruler. And we would ask you, so on a scale of 1 to 10, how likely are you to make this change? And then the person might say, well, I'm at a 7. So then I would come back, well, why a 7, not maybe a 5 or a 9? And that opens up even more. And that's just a quick, brief idea of what we do in a coaching session. And then we work towards making an action plan with you. Again, I like to keep saying this word you, because you have to have the buy-in to make the change. Nobody could help me lose weight. I've always been heavy. I had to make the decision to lose those 55 pounds and keep going. So I'm not going to ask you to do something that you don't want to do. That's about wellness coaching. So if you have a glass of wine or a cup of coffee, cup of tea, or some soup that you're sipping, I just want to take you for a moment and do a quick mindful meditation on food. And I could explain more maybe later about the benefits of mindful eating, or you can take my card and check out my website. So just for a moment, concentrate on your glass of wine, glass of water, whatever you may have at your table. I was going to say desk, I don't know why. So just take for that moment and appreciate and think about for a moment, where did it come from? Did it come from a Californian wine country, Italy? But just take a moment to really take in what went into making the wine. And then after that, you want to take in maybe the aroma, the smells. If it's water, I know that there's no smell, but can you hear the ice in the glass, in the cup? You just take that moment to really listen. Then you would take a sip and you take the sip of whatever you're drinking, and you just hold it in your mouth, and you kind of say, how does that feel? Do I really want to swallow that? That might not be so good. Don't spit it out, please. You'll have me laughing. So, sorry. And then once you swallow it, you want to see how it feels inside. So that's just a brief idea of what a meditation is. I normally like to use cuties, you know, those cute little oranges. You unwrap it, and I normally take my class to a planet far, far away, and we have to pretend like it's poison, or maybe not. So mindful eating is about slowing down, and the way that you slow down also helps you digest better and enjoy your food. And if you're watching any of the cooking shows recently, they're really talking about enjoying the food, having balance. Some people look at me, oh, you're a holistic coach, so you're vegan. No, I still eat animal protein. So again, it's about enjoying, but being respectful about your food, having gratitude. They talk about that being one of the best spices for your meal. And one last thing, it's also centered around self-compassion. And when you give yourself more compassion, you can give others more compassion. And lastly, it's also about body image. And so many people are being bullied these days, and they need these good reinforcements about what it is to be nourished by food, not, oh, that's bad, oh, that's good. You want to have not bad or good, this is just going to nourish my body. And with that, I will turn it over to Steve.
Well, have a seat. I'd like to learn something more. Now, this savoring thing's not going to work when I get a six-pack of beer. I'm usually done with that thing in a couple of hours. I'd be up all night drinking a six-pack of beer. That might not work for me, but for others, perhaps.
Yeah.
I guess on my entire curve, I'm at a one here. I'm not making that big effort for a 10 yet, am I?
No, but that's the thing. It's not about making an effort.
Okay.
It's wanting to. So do you have a favorite food, though?
Everything.
Okay.
Yeah, everything.
Okay, well, let's go with, let's say somebody makes you a good pasta dinner.
Perfect.
Okay, and so you have a good wine, a good salad, and a good pasta dinner.
I'm liking this.
Okay.
All right.
Okay. The point about it is to then take a good little fork, and again, not a full fork. You want to be able to get it into your mouth and kind of let it sit there for a moment, and you really take in the flavors. So then you taste the garlic, the fresh basil. And I look at it as you're also respecting how much work somebody puts into a meal, you know? And so, like, when my aunt cooks and I can taste something, recently I had a Brussels sprout salad for the first time, and I thought, well, I don't know. It was raw Brussels sprouts.
That sounds good.
And that's what I said. I was like, I don't know about that. But it had toasted pecans and things in it, and so it was very delicious.
Good, good. So did you just graduate from college and say, this is what I want to do, or did you do something else before you led up to this job?
No. So it took me 18 years to get my bachelor's, and my bachelor's is actually in international business.
Okay.
And from that, I took my love of international cultures and the manners and things like that. So international gift giving and things.
Where did you go to college?
Strayer University was my... I went to... CCBC, so and then I went to Strayer, and then I found out about Maryland University of Integrated Health through my acupuncturist. And while he was sticking needles in me, and I'm like, acupuncture is great. He told me about it, and actually, it took me 2 years to make the decision to go. Yeah, because I never thought I'd go back to school.
Well, that 18 years that you were going to school, what were you doing for work?
Okay, so I worked in credit unions and customer service, and then I worked for the American Urological Association for 8 years. And so I worked with doctors for 8 years with their continuing education.
I gotcha. Now, do you have an office in Easton, a storefront, so to speak, or is it everything done over the phone or internet? How do you handle your clients?
Right now, it's done over the phone or on the internet.
Okay, just a guess. I didn't know.
No, that's a very good guess. But I also teach right now in Fulton, Maryland. Because I live in Laurel, but this is, my mom and I'd like to move over this way, and we call this like our second home. We're here a lot. And I was here meeting Valerie one day and talking about what I do. So I'm also looking for places over here to do my mindful eating, and I also do crafting with a purpose, which is helping people. They craft, and so they're doing something fun, but it's meaningful. They're going to figure out, like, what their goals are for 2017 and how they can go forward to get those goals.
So you facilitate an opportunity for a solution for them. They have to come up with all their solutions, correct?
Yes. I mean, I'm there. I have resources, and I'm a guide, and I love being that, but really... people have so much wisdom inside of them, and that's really what a life coach or a health and wellness coach is there to do, is we want to bring out the wisdom that's already inside of you.
Well, I pictured a life coach calling me at 6:30 telling me, get your butt out of bed, it's time to go to work. Now, lunchtime, eat quickly, savor it, and then get back to work. It's not like that.
No, we can, of course, be an accountability partner with you. So if you want me to text you and say, get your hiney out of bed, I can do that.
Right.
But I'd probably say, how about we do this? And maybe say, you use your alarm clock, but I'll give you a motivational quote to get going.
All right. How many clients do you work with at a time?
Right now... each class normally has 5 to 10 people, and so about 5 to 10 people.
And where do you meet for these classes then?
At a yoga studio.
Oh, that's right. I did read on your bio that you're learning to become a yoga instructor.
I am.
New beginnings for you. Fantastic.
Yes.
How's that coming along? I think you've just started, if I understood correctly.
I actually start next week.
Oh, okay.
But I'm on a great journey. I can't wait.
Okay.
I can't
wait. Good. Have you done yoga, and now you're ready to be an instructor?
Yes. Yeah, I've been doing yoga for 8 years now.
Okay.
And after my lung surgery, I was in a lot of pain, and yoga was what helped me get out. Yeah.
It's supposed to be magical. I've never done it. Bending over is enough to pick something up. But I people really do enjoy it, and they get great benefits from it.
Oh,
you brought up a point in your bio. You've overcome depression. And some of your meditations and some of your coaching helps people overcome depression.
Mm-hmm.
Do you work in hand with doctors or anything because of maybe they're prescribing medication and you could potentially get the person off of that medication or anything of that nature?
No, that's a little sticky, Steve.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. Well, we don't want to violate a HIPAA law.
No. What I mean is by sticky is.
Yeah.
So, no, I don't work with a doctor just yet.
Okay.
I would love to work with doctors in helping people not only get, I've actually come off of diabetes medicine.
Mm-hmm.
I'd like to help people get off of depression medicine, whatever it is their goal would be. But getting over depression was yoga. And was learning to move.
That worked. Okay.
Right. And so a wellness coach moves you forward. We don't go backwards. There may be a little bit of murky water that we go through. So we don't go backwards. We move forwards. But the depression, I would say definitely mindful movement, getting out in nature, walking. That was what I did. I went back to my roots. That's what we did for fun. We went for nature walks, things like that. And I thought, oh, wow, that's why I say over 30 years, I can tell you that I've been doing. So that's what I went back to. And that really helped a lot. And food choices. There's a lot of great research out there showing that some food choices can actually help lower depression. And that's what I also bring to it, is some research that I can help people with, not only with depression, but other changes.
So you take a client, and maybe it's the eating, maybe it's the depression, maybe it's some avenue that they want to improve themselves on it. At what point do you kick the bird out of the nest? It looks like you can coach yourself from here on forward. Is there some telltale sign that comes up in the meeting?
when they're telling you what to do. No, seriously, I just had this happen for me. I had a young lady who took my mindful eating class, and it was so great. We were talking, and she had this moment where she figured out that it wasn't mindful eating that she needed to learn. There were some other areas that she needed to clear out, and those areas were finishing yoga teacher training, for herself, and a couple other things, and she's doing it.
Okay.
And so then they just kind of let you go.
Right.
I'm always there. They know I'm there if they want to follow up. I had another young lady who got into meditation before bed. So she was ready to fly out of the nest. I think there's some people that could, you can actually get addicted because they're more like your fan.
Yeah.
Like this person becomes a part of your life.
Right.
A part of, and that's when you have to kind of just gently wean them. So how about once a month we talk kind of thing?
All right. Now, I was watching, I can't remember, maybe Good Morning America, Today's Show, something. I can't remember what show it was, just this past week. And they had these doctors on. And they had using virtual reality headsets for teaching doctors how to do anything. With all the advent of all these electronic ideas and opportunities coming in the future, can any of those things work within the life coaching business?
To be honest, I'm going to say I don't think so.
But okay.
That's just Jenny's opinion, not based on research.
Well, Jenny's my authority on the research and opinion right here.
Well, what I'm trying to say is this. So maybe I'm over the phone and I can't touch you, but I can still hear if somebody's crying.
Mm-hmm.
How can a machine help a person? They could maybe say, oh, they're there, but they can't use their... voice, their tones, their different. Does that make sense?
So it's multi-sensual in order to overcome these issues then, obviously.
I would think so.
Yes, okay.
You want to have that human contact. I like being in contact with people, but I also like to hear people, you know, I've done it over the phone.
Well, if you were on the phone that much and these people are, they're probably, a lot of them are struggling significantly. Do you ever take that home with you, as you will? I mean, some of that pain has got to wash off on you.
I work at home. part of MUIH's program for us is becoming a healing presence. And being a healing presence, you have to heal yourself as well. So that's why I do yoga. That's why I do...
back to the yoga.
A practice.
Everybody, we all need to start doing yoga, obviously. That seems to be the cure-all.
Oh, there's so much research, actually, that it can take down inflammation, help with depression, help with weight. And there's a lot of good stuff. But I also do this practice called Qigong, which is an ancient Chinese medicine type practice, like Tai Chi. And I have two cats.
Oh. So, the cats.
Yeah,
back to the cats.
And I will just say too, just in total disclosure, I also keep a wellness coach. I have goals of my own that I want to meet. And I also like being a coach because it reminds me how vulnerable people can be. I've had a couple people cry. I've cried to my wellness coach. And so I just want to keep tapped into that humanity.
Have you written any books or are you working on any books? What is your plans for the future with the wellness coach then?
What I really want to do is own my own yoga studio where I can teach mindful eating and mindful cooking.
Okay.
And
you're looking to come over here? You're not living here currently. You're across the bridge right now, right?
Right.
Okay.
School is over there, so it's just
all right.
Better.
Are you looking at a place? Are we going to see you over here wandering the streets soon?
Soon, yes. And I'm over here quite often, almost every other week with my family.
Okay, well, very good.
Yeah.
Well, I want to thank you for coming. I appreciate it. You gave me an insight of something I knew zero about. And I think it's wonderful. Jenny, thank you very much, and good luck to you in the future.
Ladies
and gentlemen, Jenny Wickline.
Thank you so much, Steve.
Thank you. Well, I think this guy over to my left knows another song. You know one more?
No.
All right, let's do it. Let's hear more from Brent. Thanks.
Father's words.
close the laundry door. I'll tiptoe across the floor. Keep your clothes on. I've got all that I can take, yay. Teach me how to use the love that people say you've made, yay. Stop your parents' car. I just saw a shooting star. We can wish upon it, but we won't share the wish we made. Yeah. But I can't keep no secrets. I wish that you would always stay gay. Last night I dreamt the whole night long. I woke with a head full of songs. I spent the whole day, I wrote them down, but it's a shame, pain. Tonight I'll burn the lyrics, cause every chorus was your name, yay.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Steve Hazzard. I'm your Emcee this evening. We are live, recording live on Queen Anne's County Television. Please look for it on your local cable, Channel 7. We are at the Creamery on Commerce Street. It's Thursday night. It must be Thursday night at the Creamery, right? We thank you all for coming this evening. We've had a great time so far. We've only had just one guest. We're about to introduce our second guest, and it gives me great pleasure at this time to introduce a gentleman, a local author, grew up in Stevensville on Kent Island, has authored several books. Some of them are Nick Hoxter's Kent Island, The Final Visit, Yesterday, Growing Up on Kent Island, A Walk Back in Time, and his newest book, Changing Island, Kent Island. It gives me a great pleasure to welcome Nick Hoxter to the stage. I'm well.
Good.
I'm looking forward to hearing some of your writing.
I'm glad to hear.
Hearing writing. Is that correct? Anyway.
It'll work.
It'll work in a pinch, right?
Good evening. Thank you for being here this evening.
I was born in Stephenville in 1931 during the Great Depression. Spent most of my life there during the big war, as my dad used to say. He was stationed in Baltimore, and I was up there for about 2 years, and boy, was that a learning. But anyway, I came back, and I've been here ever since. My family came here from Germany in 1742. I retired from Delmarva Sachsendorf, one of the nicest companies a man could ever work for, or a woman, in Barclay, Maryland. I hope most of you people know it. It's been sold now. The Landscreener family no longer has it. But Mr. Ted Landscreener was the president of the company, the owner, and he flew sorties off of carriers in World War II, and he was a great man. I really, really enjoyed being there. Anyway, after I retired, I got very bored. I'd worked all my life, and I started doing a search of the Hoxter family. And as I went around to different places, people would say, I've got some nice pictures here you ought to have. Your granddad, he was the village blacksmith. I said, that's right. And your grandmother, great-grandmother, she was the village seamstress. I said, yeah, that's right. So I got all these pictures and all these stories. So one day I said to Billy Duddy, my good friend, I said, what am I going to do with all this? He said, do a book. I said, Aunt Emily said that you were smart, but you were lazy. So why don't you just prove that you can do this? I had no idea what I was doing. So I got together with a few friends and started gathering more and more stories. And it was amazing. I would go to some farmer in their late 80s, early 90s, and they would say, oh, you're Clay's boy. I said, no. Clay was my great-grandfather. But it opened the doors to everything I needed. And they would say, wife's cooking some crab cakes for dinner. You want to stay? You better believe it. And I would stay and have the crabs, and he would say, why don't you go upstairs, go in the attic, off on the left you'll find two boxes, his pictures and things, bring it down. And I would do it, surprising the information that was in there. And another thing which I really learned when I was in high school, I want to go back a bit, we had good teachers, excuse me, but I could go out and in the evenings and go down to Bill Denny's garage where all the old timers met, farmers, everyone came in, or go to Henry Grohman's store. I could sit there and listen to stories that I never knew existed, more than I could learn in the high school. And I remember one night we were sitting in Denny's garage and a former county commissioner said, well, you know, we were a part of the Commonwealth of Virginia for years. I never knew it. Nobody had ever talked about that. So I found a couple of books on Old Kent Island, and it was true. We had been a part of Virginia for years. William Claiborne was Secretary of State for Virginia, and he took a ship and started sailing the Chesapeake, and he came across Kent Island. He loved it so much that he bought it. Bought it from the Indians. And the Mattapeak Indians, they're all kind of Indians down there. And he and Lord Baltimore didn't get along. Lord Baltimore was from Baltimore, and he said he had the rights to Kent Island. And so the first battles in the new country, in the Chesapeake Bay, were fought between William Claiborne and Lord Baltimore. And it went on for years and years. When William Claiborne died in 1677, he had a suit against Lord Baltimore in the courts of London to try to get Kent Island back to Virginia. And I've often said and wondered, what would have happened? Where the hell would they put those bridges? Excuse me. Where would they put those bridges?
It's all right. We're not censored.
Okay. But where would they put the Bay Bridges? Because that would have been a part of Virginia. And they certainly couldn't put it there. So amazing. It's a question that we'll never have an answer to, evidently. But this is the first...
Is that the first book you wrote there?
This is the first book.
All right.
It's called Growing Up on Kent Island. And I had a friend, still have her, named Sherry Hoffman, does update. And we were on the, committees on Kent Island. And one day I said, do me a favor. You and Mike are taking the weekend off. Take this little essay with you and read it. Tell me what you think. She came back Monday. She said, let's get the press with this. This is going to be a seller. Well, to tell you the truth, it's in his third printing.
Oh.
I'm out of them again. And so many stories here are unique. I remember, hard to believe it, but I was talking about it the other day. I was in my great-grandmother's, and Bob Grimes came in, and it was a cold winter morning, and he took a chaw of tobacco, put it in his mouth, spit it in the coal stove, and my great-grandmother said, Bob, where are you going today? He said, I got to skin a mule this morning. I said, skin a mule? I never heard of anything. So when he left, I said, man, that's not true, is it? He's not, oh, yeah, I said, they make good blankets, horse blankets, mule. I said, I never heard of that, anything like that in my life. But as I grew older, I learned a lot of things that I never knew existed. And as I was doing this first book, so many pictures were coming to me from old Islanders that I said, I've got to do another book because we need a pictorial, all these beautiful pictures. And I found some old postcards. I sent them away to Blacksburg or somewhere down in Virginia and had them all redone. And I remember my printer saying, you're not going to sell this book and make money if you're going to put pictures like this in there. I said, well, you don't understand. Someday all this will be gone. And all we're going to have are these books. They'll be in the libraries and schools. And people will know what it's like if they can see it. I'm so glad I did it. That second book has really been a good seller. Later on, after I retired from Delmarva Session Door, a lot of pictures came to me. And I said, I think I'll do a third book. My wife said, now you spent enough money. But anyway, she had a very good job working in the law firm at Easton. And I went in and started the third book. Boy, the time I got it, it was sold out. And I said, my God, I can't believe this, that people were so hungry for information on the old island. And I was just so glad that it had come to me, and I was privileged to do this. And I didn't do a third printing. My wife became very sick, and I was working on a book. And she said, be sure and do this book if I'm gone. So I hadn't, when she died, I had no desire to do it. But my daughter came home, my granddaughters, and they said, we're going to help you finish this book. So the fourth book is This Changing Island, Kent Island. And in doing it, I was speaking... one day in Easton at a senior center, and this lady was a guest speaker also, and she said, they introduced her and said, her father was a captain on the ferries. I said, no, he wasn't. No, I said, I worked on the ferries, and I knew every captain there. I served with all of them. Well, come to find out, he was B. Frank Sherman, who was the chairman of the ferries. Very fine gentleman. And he had left a lot of pictures, but he hadn't put any names on them back. So as his daughter was showing them, I took several of them. I said, oh, I know who this is. And I said, you should know this. This is Pinky down the shore. And she said, if you know all these, why can't we get together and we'll go over them? So one day I went to her home and we sat down, and I spent about 3 hours. and I got some of the most wonderful pictures of the Chesapeake Bay Ferry and the people who worked on them, and I knew them, knew so many of them. The reason I left the ferries in 1952 was the Bay Bridge was going to open. And I was married, had two children. I said, I can't stay here and wait for something. I got to go find a job. So where did I go? I went to work on the railroad. And that lasted about 5 years, and then I had to go work again. But it was a privilege to work on the railroad. I was a young man, and the others were old, and the supervisor came one day, and he said, I'd like to talk to you. You're young, and you seem to be ambitious. How would you like to become a foreman? And I said, I've been thinking about it. He said, well, you'll have to take a test to become qualified. So I did, and I was sent to Wilmington and Dover. I was sent to Clayton, Delaware, Smyrna. And one day the word came that they were going to take the tracks up from Love Point to Queenstown. And my foreman, fine old gentleman, came to me. He was my Sunday school superintendent. He came to me and said, Nicholas, I'm too old for this. You should bid it in. We were union. And I said, well, I didn't want to step on your toes, but I've been thinking about it. And he said, well, go ahead and bid it in. I won't fool with it. So I bid it in, and I took the tracks up from Love Point to Stephenville. We stored everything at the Stephenville station. Then we brought a train in, loaded everything on gondolas or flat cars, whatever we had. And then I took the tracks up from there to Chester. And when I got to Chester, we weren't allowed to touch the bridges. That was a separate group of men. And I got thinking, well, Bus Tanner's had his farm forever, and he has two farms, and the only way he gets over here is to drive across an old railroad bridge with his tractor. So I said to the foreman of the bridge department, I said, do me a favor, and just don't take anything up, let it stay. He needs that. That's his livelihood. And he said, well, you're asking me to volley the kind of a trust, but he said, we'll see what happens. So he just went on and he left it there. So when they were building the trail, I got a call one day from Wes Johnson. He said, Nick, I got to ask you a question. What year did the railroad come to Stephenville? I said, 1902. He said, what year did they build the railroad, to build the bridge at Tanner's farm? I said, 1902. And he said, when did they rebuild it? I said, never was rebuilt in my lifetime. He said, do you know that we are going to build right on top of the existing piling, which had been there since 1902? I said, they built it right in those days. And they did. If you go down there today, and I've been down there and looked at it, it's built right on top of those existing piling. A lot of people don't know, but Love Point in its heyday was really the in place. The railroad had a turntable there. When you came into Love Point and you had to go down to the pier for your passengers, you had to have a turntable to turn it around so you could back down to the pier and take the cars. And there were shops there. They did all the work. Everything was done at Love Point. Then they built the Love Point Hotel, which was amazing, just amazing. And a lot of people don't know, but in 1937, I was a little kid, they had a carnival at the Love Point Hotel out on the front lawn. And my grandparents took me up there, and they had a Ferris wheel, carousel, They had planes flying over. They had parachutes jumping out. It was the most amazing thing. And I saw on Facebook some time ago, someone inquiring said, does anyone have anything on the Love Point Hotel when they had the carnival? And I thought, yeah, I've got it. Well, I looked it up and I found it. 1937. And it was just amazing. And I remember now, this was back in the times of the Great Depression. And I had a friend call me and he said, I have to ask you a question. He said, when Dad sold the farm on Kent Island and moved to Graysonville, and I went back to see my grandparents, I would take the train. I said, makes sense. He said, you stated in your book that there was a station at the Narrows. I said, there was. He said, where was it? I said, it was out on the pier. And I said, the reason for it, at the bottom, the boats could pull in, bring crabs or oysters, whatever the season would be, unload them, take a chain fall, bring them up. When the train come in, they put them on, took them to Bluff Point, went on the ferry, they went to Light Street in Baltimore and unloaded them. And he said, I never knew that. Do you have a picture? I said, somewhere, don't ask me where, but somewhere I do have a picture of that station. And I did find it.
Well, Brent, I tell you what, you've given us a world of information concerning Kent Island. I'd like to know a little bit about you. You grew up in Kent Island, right? Have a seat. Have a seat with me here.
Well, there's not much to me.
Well, there's a lot to you. You possess a lot of knowledge. What are you talking about? Here, have a seat right here, Brent. Come on, Nick. Have a seat. So you've written these four books. It's all been done from hearsay, from other fellas that you met.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Not a lot of fact-checking or anything. It was just a bunch of guys telling stories and everything else, right?
The amazing thing was when I started doing all this, there were still a lot of people in their 80s and their 90s.
Right.
They didn't want this to die. They wanted to share it.
Right.
So there I was.
So it's a living history. Oh, I'm sorry. Hold that bike like that. I got the producers calling me and everything else. Let them back out of our conversation. Right? So you've written four books. Are you working on a fifth?
Well, playing around a little bit.
You got a lot of pictures left?
Well, the amazing thing is this. Ever so often, I'll get a letter with some pictures in it.
Mm-hmm.
It may come from the state of Washington.
Mm-hmm.
It may come from California. And they'll say, great granddad passed away last month.
Mm-hmm.
And in his books that he had that you had written, I found these pictures. I know he'd want you to put them in the next book.
Oh, that's fantastic. Now, where can our people get these books? Where can our audience buy these books at?
Well, in Stevensville.
Okay.
The Love Point Deli.
Yeah. Oh, do they? Okay. Yeah. Oh, all four? Okay.
And then the Gifted Crab down at Chester.
Oh, yeah. I know where that is. I finally went in there.
Oh, did
you? Yeah. Well, I drove past it enough going through that circle. I figured, you know, I should
they
go
do,
in there.
They do a real good job. Both of them do a good job. And in Easton, it's the News Center.
Okay. All right. And you don't know if you're working on another one, huh?
Well, I'm not passing it away. If somebody sends me something, I store it. I put it in files.
Grew up in Stevensville. Went to Stevensville High School, then, I presume? Good student? A student?
No.
Horrible
student.
Oh. How does a horrible student go to write books? See,
well, that's what Mrs. Denny would say if she was like. But J. Fred Stevens was our teacher, was our principal.
Okay.
And he was my neighbor.
Uh-huh.
And he called me one day. I used to do work for him.
Right.
Cut grass and do things.
All right. Evidently, there's a problem with the mic, but that's all right.
I'm sorry.
That's all right. Well, it ain't anything you did.
You guys keep going.
Okay. And,
don't mind me.
We're just going to get this last story in. I know we got other folks
don't
to talk
me.
To. So get this one in.
I don't want to get
you
talking.
Well, you already started.
But anyway, he said.
Where's the switch?
He said, you're not dumb, but you're lazy. And he said, you're going to fail if you don't do something.
Forced you to do something, huh?
And he said, I'll help you.
Oh, that was wonderful.
Across here at nighttime. Oh, he was a great man.
Man, that's fantastic.
We had wonderful teachers.
Yeah.
We had wonderful teachers.
Well, that education got you going, and then all of a sudden now you're doing books and an author. After you're long gone, these books are still going to be around.
I hope so.
I hope they are.
Just what was here.
Yeah. Well, it's fascinating stuff. It really is.
I'm going to let you go.
Nick, thank you very much. Ladies and gentlemen, Nick Hoxter. Brent, let's warm them up again. Let's go.
Very good.
They were young when the men came calling. All the girls begging not to go. Tell your families that you love them. For tomorrow you're leaving home. They'll take the train out past the old oak tree, where they used to sit and talk and dream of bigger things. Back then the world seemed so out of reach, with the imaginary chains around their feet. They'll learn to fight with gun in hand. Is that the price you pay to be a man? The ship was sturdy, the ocean was vast. All they wanted was just one chance. Unaware, they didn't know what to expect. It wasn't like the seasons on their heads. Across the way, there was a red sunset, and their old lives they would soon forget. Back at home, their families waited for news of their sons. And every day they keep waiting for the news, but never come. They said, don't go, please don't go. We miss you so. How we miss you so. Won't you come back home? Won't you come on back home? We miss you so. How we miss you so. Shots flew like flies buzzing round their heads. Too soon they will be missing their friends. They thought of love and pain in lives that don't exist, or they'll never see their families again. No, they'll never see their families again. No, they'll never see their families again. No, they'll never see their families again. They said, don't go. Please don't go. We miss you so. Oh, how we miss you so. Won't you come back home? Won't you come on back home? 'Cause we miss you so. Oh, how we miss you so.
Well, we've listened to Brent fill in all evening for us. It's time to hear a little bit about old Brent. Born and raised on the Eastern Shore, Brent has been working to make a name for himself in the local music community, always exploring new opportunities. Brent has collaborated with many different musicians while at the same time pursuing his solo musical adventures, which we've heard today. Brent's music can be described as a blending of folk, country, Americana, with influences from all genres. His songs are a fusion of storytelling intermingled with attempts to explore his own experiences of life and how it interacts with the world around us. Ladies and gentlemen, let's hear it for Brent Schraffenberger. Well, Brent, the Beatles or the Rolling Stones?
The Beatles.
Well, okay.
Every time.
All right. Well, very good. Favorite musician?
Ooh, that's a tough one. It changes daily.
Okay, right today. Let's deal with today now.
My favorite band right now is probably the Lumineers.
Lumineers. I know someone else in this room that likes the Lumineers quite a bit.
Yeah.
All right. So how did you start playing guitar?
I actually started with music playing saxophone in middle school.
Okay.
Like a lot of people probably. And then eventually I got kind of tired of people telling me to practice. And then I started playing guitar in about ninth grade of high school and then just kind of took off and never stopped playing.
And it wasn't practices anymore. It was fun, right?
Exactly.
Okay.
Fun, yeah.
All right. So you write a lot of your original music. We've heard some here tonight.
Yep.
Where do you do your writing? Is there a room in the house? Is there a garage in the car?
No, it's really all over the place.
Is
it? Because like you'll get inspiration kind of hits you everywhere.
Yeah.
So I might write a piece of some lyrics when I'm out driving around. I might write some guitar parts when I'm at home and then sort of kind of make it all fit together.
Well, that brings up another question, though. Do you write the lyrics first or the music first?
It changes, surprisingly. I would say...
I can't pin you down, can I?
On average, I would say I do the lyrics first. I try to keep a notebook on me and just jot down stuff and then kind of do some guitar. But there's some songs where I've kind of pieced it all together at the same time, too.
Right.
So it changes. You got to switch it up or you get stagnant.
Now, do you play any other instrument? You mentioned the saxophone, but that was short-lived. Do you play piano? Do you play drums?
I play keyboard. I can play some drums, some bass guitar, electric guitar.
So you don't need anybody else in your band?
No, it's just me. I don't need anyone.
But you don't need it. I know you play with Del Fox, right? You still play with them?
Yep, absolutely.
Okay, and that's going well. What do you do during the daytime? Do you live off of your music, or do you have another job?
I actually work for a mental health organization.
Okay.
Dealing with people with depression, schizophrenia.
Hey, where's our coach?
So I'm an employment specialist, which is just a fancy way of saying I help people get jobs.
Oh, okay. Are you working on any CDs currently, or do you have a CD? I first should ask.
I don't
even know that.
I don't have a CD right now, but I am in the process of recording and putting together a full-length album. I have it basically all written. It's just finding the right musicians to sit
right.
in on certain...
So tracks. You're not happy with the guys from Del Fox?
They'll be on it.
Okay, all right. I don't want to spread any rumors.
I like to spread the love. There's so many talented people around here that it's hard to stick to one.
Where do you go around here to do a recording? Is it over in Ann Arbor? Is there a studio there? Or do you...
Surprisingly, there's a lot of options, but I will focus mostly in the Annapolis area. There's a really strong music scene there. A lot of really professional studios.
All right. So let me ask you this. If you could ask one question of any of your favorite musical industry artists, what would that one question be? Of anybody you can imagine.
Of anyone I can imagine.
Yeah.
Alive?
No, go ahead. Go ahead. You run with this.
I would probably say, what made it the easiest for you to push yourself to that next level? Because everyone kind of wants to be a professional musician.
Right.
But there's always seems to be kind of this in-between where you can get to a certain level, and then it's really hard to break that that glass.
Is that where you're at right now, bumping your head on that ceiling?
I think I'm quite there.
Oh, okay.
I'm just having fun.
Okay. What are your plans then? What's your future? You want to get the album done, I presume, right?
Get the album done, keep playing more and more shows. I play a lot around here at the Jetty, at Poorhouse Pub. Right here at Good Guys. I'm actually playing on Saturday if anybody's
here. Yeah, plug it, baby. Plug it.
Yeah.
I'm not getting paid, and neither are you. You got to work an angle. I get it.
Yeah, so it's just the more shows, the better. Because it's in this industry, it's not really about selling albums anymore, unfortunately.
No, really.
No.
Okay. Any advice you'd give some of our budding musical artists out here looking to make it?
Really, the only way to do it is just to get out there and play as much as you can. A lot of people get kind of down about themselves if they're not playing a lot of shows or if they're not getting a lot of stuff, and it takes years before you really can start breaking into the scene and
becoming kind of respected.
So like when we watch those old movies from the 70s where there's an agent from Hollywood sitting in the back corner and he's getting noticed and he wants to write a con, that doesn't work like
that. Happen.
Doggone it.
Especially nowadays.
I thought the movies were real life.
I know, me too. Mm. It would be nice, but...
Mm-hmm. It sure would be. So where do you see yourself then 10 years from now, musically and personally?
That's a tough question.
That's a long plan.
I'm hoping I'm still playing music. Okay. I mean, if I'm not doing it professionally full time, it is what it is. I just kind of do it for the love of it anyway.
Right.
But I'm hoping it'll be my full time job, and that's all I'll be doing.
You grew up here?
Yep. Grew up right down the road.
Okay. I thought so. I remember reading that somewhere.
Yep.
Okay. Fantastic. So we're working on an album. We don't have it yet.
Not quite.
Okay.
Getting there.
All right. Well, I'm hoping you have one soon because we've sure enjoyed you this evening. And I'd like to give you a couple more minutes to get ready because I'd like to hear one more. And I'm going to close out the show. But I really appreciate you coming. And again, he's not getting paid. All right? So,
neither am I.
But he's not getting paid. So go see him at some of the venues. Keep an eye out on it in the Bay Times and some of the others. And it's a good way for you to get a nice evening with entertainment and whatnot. We've had a great time tonight. We've had Brent Schraffenberger. We've had Jenny Wickline. We still have one more. I haven't forgotten. And we've had Nick Hoxter. And by the way, Nick has actually brought some books for sale. And so when you leave through the gift shop, just like in Disney World, you'll have to go through the gift shop, buy a book. All right? The man didn't put all that effort in there to just have those things sitting around collecting dust, hauling them back and forth from show to show. All right? I just need you to tell you that. So tonight has been New Beginnings. It's January. It's 2017. And you know what's funny about 2017? How many of you screwed that up on a check yet? I haven't really. And then I say to myself, oh, that's because I pay everything online. So... when the money's there. Anyway, so next month will be February 16th, and we'll be right here in the same place, and we're going to have two watermen that are going to do some storytelling, setting us up for the Storytelling Festival, which is in the following month. We'll have Piano Ted. We'll have Jack Schramm, who is an author and has written stories about steamboats on the Chesapeake Bay. So that should be interesting, too. And, of course, our theme for February 16th, what do you think it's going to be?
Love.
Right? And I love every one of you for coming. I really do. All right. So without any further ado, I'd like to thank the Creamery. Thank Val and Rick for allowing us the space. Queen Anne's County Television, thank you very much for recording this event. Look for it on YouTube. Look for it on Queen Anne's County Television, Channel 7. And you can replay all the 5 previous episodes, if so desires, through YouTube. Then watch this weekend during the ice storm, perhaps. Before I leave, I have here with us this evening the Black Knights. And the Black Knights are going to a choir group located here locally. They're going to accompany Brent on the last two songs. You have your song sheets. You have your harmonica. And so, if you will, enjoy yourself, and I'm going to turn it over to Fred, and I'm going to bid you an adieu, and thank you very much for coming.
Right.
See you next month.
All right, now how about everyone look on your table. There's music, all right? We're going to start out with This Land Is Yours Land. Now, don't worry. If you don't know how to sing, this woman ready is trying to sneak under the table. Hey, when you hear us sing, you know what bad music is, all right? So, you got your copies?
Okay.
We're just going to do the 4 stanzas. Now, before I introduce the music, let me introduce the crowd. Craig, just say who you are and where you're going next week.
I'm Craig Wright, and I'm heading to Florida Tuesday. For 2.5 months.
I'm James Watson, going to the moon.
Now, James saw me in the street. James, you always see James around town riding a bike. That's James, okay? He said to me, Fred, where's that good-looking sweatshirt? Well, I said, if you show up Thursday night, I'm going to give you. He had no idea what the hell was going to happen to him. So he's here. Charles, where are you? Come on.
Charles Emery, and I'm going back to work.
Jeff Drake, going to the moon as well.
Hey, all right, music in front of you. We're going to start on 3 and I belt it out. I don't care how bad or good you sound. It's going to feel good. Ready? 1, 2, 3.
This land is your land. This land is my land. From California to New York Island. From the Redwood Forest to the Gulf Stream waters. This land. I was walking that ribbon of highway, I saw above me that endless skyway. I saw below me that golden valley. This land was made for you and me.
Two more stanzas, let's go.
I roamed and rambled, I followed my footsteps to the sparkling sands of her diamond deserts. And all around me, a voice was sounding, this land was made for you and me.
Last stanza, shout it out.
When the sun came shining, and I was strolling, and the wheat fields waving, and the dust clouds rolling, as the fog was lifting, a voice was chanting,
nice and loud,
this land was made for you and me.
Give yourself a nice hand.
Let's hear it. Let's get over the camera.
Now what's going? Now that's ended. You know, this country.
That's it.
We got one more. James wants to know how much he's getting paid tonight.
Oh, my goodness gracious.
You're picking up the checks for all these people, all right. Okay? You know, this country, I don't know how you guys feel, 2015, 2016, and especially the election, I don't care whose side you're on, what a mess. So, you know, it's about time. Unity is a theme tonight. Let's pull it all together. And whether you're Democrat, Republican, Communist, Nudist, Green Party, we don't care. We can overcome all of our problems. And if music doesn't do it, one of Nick's books will do it for you. Nice bargain out in the hallway, all right? So that's do We Shall Overcome. That's do the whole thing. Now, come on, let's get the ceiling up and shaking a little bit. Ready? One, two, three.
We shall overcome. We shall overcome. We shall overcome someday. We shall overcome someday. We'll walk hand in hand. We'll walk hand in hand. We'll walk hand in hand someday. Oh, deep in my heart, I do believe we shall overcome someday. We shall live in peace. We shall live in peace. We shall live in peace someday. Oh, deep in my heart, I do believe we shall overcome someday. We are not afraid. We are not afraid. We are not afraid today. Oh, deep in my heart, I do believe we shall overcome someday.
Home stretch, here we go.
The whole world wide around. The whole world wide around. The whole world wide around someday. Oh, deep in my heart, I do believe we shall
someday. Happy New Year. Let's make 17 a good one.